Good evening, and welcome to Tampa Theatre. Sort of. Tonight is a first for us. It's the first time we've ever streamed a performance live. And yes, I said performance, because although it is a silent film from 1926, it is most definitely a performance, since the music will be performed live by the incomparable Stephen Ball at the Tampa Theatre's Mighty Wurlitzer Theatre Organ. Now, ironically, I have always said that you should never, ever watch a silent film on TV, because to fully appreciate the art form, you need to experience a silent film in person, in a great historic movie palace, with a huge crowd and great live musical accompaniment. And when you put all of that together, it's really very special. But since the COVID public health crisis prevents us from inviting 1,200 people to surround me here this evening, we thought we would use today's technology to stream it to you live, and hopefully make your evening a bit more cheerful. I want to thank the amazing staff of the theater for putting this together under very trying circumstances, and I want to thank our members and donors for being so generous in support of the theater during this emergency. Most of all, I want to thank you for following us on Facebook and staying in touch with us as we navigate these times together. I hope you enjoy this evening's live performance by Stephen Ball at the Tampa Theatre's Mighty Wurlitzer, performing his original score for Buster Keaton's 1926 masterpiece, The General.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Stephen Ball. I'm so happy to be with you this evening for a very special performance, unique in the entire 94-year history of the Tampa Theater. As you heard from Mr. Bell earlier, this is a first for us, not only at the Tampa Theater in the live presentation of a silent film virtually, but also quite possibly a first anywhere in the performance of a film on its original sound equipment live from a movie palace. We hope sometime very soon we're going to be able to welcome the general public back here. You know, until we do, just to put into perspective what an amazing place this is, this 1926 movie palace designed by John Everson was his favorite theater. It cost approximately $100,000 a month, even without people coming in the front door, just to maintain the building and maintain the very talented staff which have put this show together. Your donations at www.tampatheater.org/give are what's helping fund us keeping this project alive so that the vision and this dream of an amazing magical space, a frame, if you will, that frames the beautiful motion pictures that are presented here. So this dream stays alive. Without your support, it wouldn't be possible. The film tonight was not an accidental choice. We have a holiday weekend here. This is the Memorial Day weekend. And of course, this is a motion picture about about our armed forces, the armed forces of the Civil War. What's most interesting about this film, if you've never had the chance to see it before, is that it's real history. This 1926 film documents actual historical events from 1862. And I won't give away the plot, I'm gonna make you see the film, but what's interesting about what you will see with the action of the Union soldiers is that they were the first recipients of the Medal of Honor in 1863. So that Medal of Honor was created because of the actions of the 21 Union soldiers, which you'll see in the first part of the film. It's a remarkable piece of cinematography. It cost almost $750,000 to produce. That was an enormous fortune in that time. The film initially didn't do very well at the box office. It opened a few months after the theater here opened. The theater opened its doors on October 15th, 1926, the film officially opened January 3rd, I believe it was, 1927, so just after the new year. And it had almost $500,000 in revenue, but it wasn't considered a success until much later. It was reevaluated and is now considered one of the greatest masterpieces ever to come out of Hollywood. I hope you enjoy this evening's score, which is provided for you on the original THX system of the Tampa Theater, with a few augmentations and changes over the years. The Wurlitzer pipe organ is the culmination of about a 3,000-year historical progression in the technology of organ building. And what you're going to see me playing here is the control panel for a much larger machine. It weighs about 6 tons. It's housed out of sight behind the proscenium walls, so you don't see the organ playing, you only hear it. And if I do my job correctly, the greatest compliment you could possibly give to me is that you completely forgot I was there. Everything happens in real time. You're seeing a sort of patchwork quilt, an assembly of different musical ideas, each one being associated with different characters in real time, and a machine which is specifically designed to provide some of the sound effects, or foley, as we say, that you would expect to hear when action takes place on the screen. It's really a remarkable thing to watch an organist doing this in real time, and because of the magic of the technology we're using tonight, and the very special nature of the production, which the Tampa Theatre has put together, for the first time in this production, you'll actually be able to see me in real time in relationship to what's going on in the film. I hope you enjoy this evening's show, and at the very end of the performance tonight, we'll also have the opportunity to answer any of your questions in real time. Meanwhile, sit back, enjoy Buster Keaton, a man who's larger than life and whose art speaks more loudly than any words he could say in his time. I'm so happy you're with us. Thank you for coming. Sit back and enjoy the show.
Thank you. Thank you.
I hope you're enjoying this evening's presentation of Buster Keaton's favorite film in John Eberson's favorite theater. Of course, it's a pity that we can't welcome you to the Tampa Theatre this evening. I realize some of the audience tonight will have been here and is very familiar with this place, and other people watching this presentation will have never been here. I hope for those of you that have never had the opportunity to visit, we've inspired you to come and take a look and experience this national treasure as soon as we do open. There were about 35,000 visitors, we expect, who were affected by the coronavirus, or would-be visitors, I should say, to this theater. Since the theater's been closed, it's been a real problem to explain to people how difficult it is to really operate this building without an audience. The Tampa Theater Foundation is a 501c3 nonprofit, and for those of you who happen to be watching from outside the United States, you may not be aware of the importance of philanthropy in the United States. These organizations earn revenue, of course, by selling tickets and concessions, but also by requesting gifts of money, not only from individuals like yourselves, but foundations as well. And this is really what makes up the bulk of the operating budget. So when an organization like the Tampa Theater has to close its doors to the people it's meant to serve, it makes things financially quite difficult, as I know it is for all of the audience right now. The virus has affected the economy of the entire world. Still, if you have the opportunity, consider making a donation. TampaTheater.org/give is the easiest and best way to do that. We're grateful to all of the donors who made this evening's performance possible. It's a tease in a way. It's a way to give you a taste of the real thing, the magic that is this place, what's been described before as one of the most beautiful theaters in the world. And what you're experiencing tonight is an art form, an entertainment for which this place was designed. Silent films are some of the most unique entertainment provided by the Tampa Theater. This is a world-class venue in a very unique location geographically. You may have noticed part of our unique geography here during the train chase sequence in the first act. If it sounded like, in addition to the steam train we had coming from the organ, there was a diesel train. In fact, there was a diesel train going by on Polk Street behind me. Polk Street butts up to the theater house, stage house, and for that reason, the stage house has never been able to be extended because we have an active rail line running in the back of the building. And so, miraculously, at exactly the right moment in this evening's film, we had a real train coming by, honking its horn, almost perfectly in time with this evening's film. It's part of the unique mystery and magic of the Tampa Theater. I'm sure the train and all of the ghosts here were just as happy to be in their own way a part of the show. I'll be back at the end of the film for a few questions, if you have any. I am so happy that you've been able to tune in and enjoy this evening's presentation. I hope you'll be able to come here and experience the Tampa Theater live and in person sometime very soon. And I hope that this all finds you in good health. On behalf of the very dedicated and extremely talented staff of the Tampa Theater, I'd like to wish you all a wonderful and safe evening and continued enjoyment of this marvelous piece of American cinema. Thank you for watching.
Thank you.
Thank you all so much for watching this evening's program. I'm very glad that you were able to enjoy The General in an original movie house virtually for the first time here, a first for the Tampa Theatre in its 94 years. But the organ and the film and the institution, which this is, all sort of carry the day as they will once this epidemic is passed. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you have any questions this evening, I'm happy to answer them. I'll begin by telling you a little bit about the organ. The organ is a very ancient instrument. It's almost 3,000 years old. What you heard is a tailor-made instrument designed originally mostly from the inventions and patents of an English immigrant to the United States who came here at the very first part, literally around 1901 or so, of the 20th century. His name was Robert Hope Jones, and he patented many of the devices, the special effects which you're hearing. All of the music coming from the organ is produced by compressed air. So you're either hearing air running through one of the 1,400 or so organ pipes, which are located up behind either wall of the proscenium arch here, or they're powering actual percussion instruments, so glockenspiels or cymbals or drums, which have pneumatically powered mallets. This is all controlled from this control panel here, the only visible part of the instrument. As you see, it's on an elevator. It's designed to go out of sight, so it disappears from your peripheral vision while watching the film. The organ worked in consort with an orchestra. The Tampa Theatre originally had a 17-piece orchestra. The organist was expected to play not only the films, but also along with the orchestra for vaudeville and any sort of musical accompaniment that the orchestra needed as well. So one of the questions that we have from our viewers is, does the organist improvise, or is the music score for each silent film? This picture is by United Artists. United Artists is a fairly late arrival in the film scene. Silent film is really the first 40 years of motion picture. It starts in about 1893, 1894, and by the time the system gets large enough to have a film company, so a corporation which can produce films commercially, they begin to have ideas very early on that music enhances the emotional effect of the film. But it takes some time, literally decades, for the motion picture producers to get large enough to have a music office, a music department in their studio. And so the answer to your question is, many films in the later period do have scores that were issued. In fact, this one, I will give you an example here because it happens to be right close at hand. This is the original cue sheet. I'm not sure how well this is coming through from Paramount Pictures for this film. And in case you can't see all of the detail here, what you have is each one of the scenes listed in order with an exact time for how many minutes normally, plus or minus, the technology, the projector is another conversation, but about how many minutes would be in each scene, and then a suggested bit of music to go along with it. This was to provide some consistency. The films were released about once a week, to provide some consistency across the 7,000 or so motion picture theaters that had organs at that time, they gave these suggestions to the organist frequently. Oftentimes, though, organists compose their own scores, as I usually do, or assemble them from period sources of music, which is what you heard tonight. So, to go back to the first part of the question, is there improvisation? Yes, definitely. The improvisation weaves together these themes, pieces of chosen music, if you will, that are associated with each character. This technique became more and more advanced as time went on. By 1929, entire scores with orchestra were released with the motion picture, and I'm thinking of, in this case, Huppert's famous score to Metropolis. That actually traveled Europe for 6 months with its own orchestra before seeing general release. I have a question here. What is your favorite Keaton film to score? Probably this one, actually. It's very difficult with Keaton because he's so talented. And Keaton was, I think, the first real artist to recognize the subtlety of the motion picture camera. How, rather than stage action, acting, which is called really the Delsarte school of acting, where you see these greatly amplified gestures, the performer from the stage trying to convey to the very last row of the theater the idea, the emotional effect, with Keaton, for the first time, you see him recognizing the intimacy of the camera and just the most subtle facial expressions. For instance, in this evening's film, with the boxcar scene, where the boxcar first appears in front of the train and then it disappears, that very subtle blinking of the eyes. For the most part, that would not have been visible in a 19th century stage theater. And that's also why, in some cases, with these motion pictures, if you watch silent film a lot, you'll see early films, the acting is very different than the later films, where narrative storytelling got much better, and the subtlety of the action and the acting and the camera shots became much better as well. How much rehearsal time goes into preparing a performance such as this? The average length of time for me to get a motion picture score ready for a feature-length film, which is what you saw, is about 40 hours. And this is from start to finish. What happens as a part of this process, I'm actually trying to do this in a very authentic way, the way that we know it was done in the 1920s and the later part of that film era. It's in a very authentic way because it was taken very seriously then. Anytime a performer playing a film score does something that distracts the audience from the film, it's the wrong thing to do. In the 1920s, film accompaniment was seen as high art, and it was considered a musical task worthy of a lot of study. So the procedures they used, to begin by looking at the film scene by scene, and then choosing from a library of hundreds or really thousands of pieces of music which might be appropriate, and then gluing them all together to have the maximum emotional impact, that process really hasn't changed at all from silent film times all the way to the present. The most famous and effective musical scores in the present day use the same techniques as the silent picture composers. So again, the answer to the question, just in brief, is about 40 hours for me for a feature film. How long have I been playing? I have been playing something with a keyboard since longer than I can remember. I've always been fascinated with the organ in particular because it is an intersection, a perfect intersection of art and music and engineering. And I was very fortunate to grow up in a household which supported my interests. My mom and my dad were both very excited about my interest in music. In fact, my dad helped me build a pipe organ in my basement when I was 6 years old. But that's a story for another evening. But at any rate, it's this combination of the mechanical and the musical and the engineering, the technical, which is what's so exciting for me. And ultimately, that's why the instrument will continue to evolve. People forget or perhaps don't realize that the organ is not static. You know, for the first 2,000 years of its existence, it was playing in public entertainment venues and in theaters. We know the organ was very popular in the Greek and Roman theaters of the time. It was one of the few instruments that was loud enough to have great carrying power. It didn't arrive in the Western church until about 1,000 years ago. And so its role as an accompanimental instrument was very well adapted to the liturgy. Finally, when it comes to the motion picture theater, it's doing what it's always done. It's being part of the show, it's accompanying, but it's doing it in this for this very new form of technology. If you think about it, the organ is doing today exactly what the organ did in Bach's time. It was playing basso continuo at the bottom of an orchestra. Well, this instrument evolved into something that many rock fans might know, the Hammond organ. And the Hammond organ is very much alive and well in popular music culture. You can hear it in most pop and certainly a lot of country as the background, the glue that's holding harmonically the whole ensemble together. Does Keaton do his own stunts? Yes, Keaton does all of his own stunts. This film was famous for a number of reasons. It's one of the two times in Keaton's entire career he was hurt on the set of a picture. You may remember the water tower scene where the water is coming out of at great pressure. That was one of the times where he was pinned against the track actually experienced, I think it was a broken leg because of that. There were all sorts of interesting disasters while this film was being shot. The original budget for the film was about $450,000. We think the film ended up costing closer to $750,000. The single shot at the end of the film with a great train crash alone cost about $42,000. That was the single most expensive shot in all of motion picture history up until that time. Keaton was meticulous with his stunt work. It was highly athletic. And according to the stories that I've read about the filming of this, it happened up in Cottage Grove, Oregon in 1926, summer of 1926. The whole crew and all the cast would go out and play baseball on Sundays. And based on everything that has been conveyed about those baseball games, Keaton easily could have been a professional baseball player. So yes, he's a very athletic man and very agile. Everything you see on the camera is real. Just wondering how you like the council you're playing in St. Louis compared to New Jersey. This is from Scott, The organs he's referring to, the console that we're talking about here, is a Wurlitzer instrument. A Wurlitzer instrument built by the Wurlitzer Company of North Tonawanda, New York. Wurlitzer was the largest producer of theater organs in their day. In 1927 alone, they produced one organ a day. So remember at the beginning of the show, I mentioned it's about 6 tons of equipment here, and this is a small size instrument. The instrument he's probably referring to is the Fox Theater in St. Louis, which has one of the 5 Fox specials, as they're called, the largest regular production model of theater organ ever built. That instrument has 4 keyboards and 36 sets of organ pipes. This particular instrument has 3 keyboards and 14 sets of pipes, although I'll mention you only heard 12 of them tonight. Hopefully you didn't notice, but there's a lot of technical work going on with the organ right now, so it wasn't all available for the performance. That's a quick answer to your question. I hope you've all enjoyed this evening's performance. You are also welcome to contact me by my website or Facebook page, Stephen Ball Musician on Facebook, or info@stephenball.com. That's my email for the website, which is just myname.com. Thank you all for tuning in. I'm going to close this show with perhaps the greatest anthem ever written to the art of motion picture. This is Richard Whiting's famous Hooray for Hollywood.